When we Indians are united, we are freaking unbeatable. That is the core message of King Suvendev's story.
What is your favorite cuisine or food type?
I love Italian and I love Lebanese. Yeah, outside of Indian, of course. Indian though, of course. But Italian and Lebanese. P.V. Narasimha Rao, our former Prime Minister, his book, The Insider, he was a brilliant scholar. Wasn't just a great leader, he was a brilliant scholar. And I'm reading this non-fiction book called 1177 BC. I enjoyed Money Heist and I enjoyed The Last Kingdom. I wake up 5:30, yoga, pranayama, puja. My exercise is normally in the evening, so I start cycling now.
Amish, it's a pleasure again to have you. Within a span of 2-3 months, I think I'm lucky to have met you again, and this time with your book, and I'm carrying it up. So I have something to flaunt. You send me this book. I'm very, very grateful you did that, because I think after long I have read a book or started reading. I'm into it right now and I am quite enjoying it. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. It's an absolute pleasure.
It's been a tremendous success. I don't know how you define success. I define it, why I'm telling you. Every day I got up, I'm a Twitter crazy girl. And there is not a single day in the last few days to say, somebody or the other has tweeted, thank you, Amish, for the book. Thank you, Amish, for the book. How did you make it reach to the masses? It's gone to everybody's house.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm just lucky, I guess, that the readers... like my books. I think, you know, if a story actually connects to the zeitgeist of the time, the mood of the times, then the chances of it becoming successful are that much higher, right? So, what is every story has a core purpose, right? What is the core purpose of King Suhaildev's story? You know, that when we Indians are united, we are freaking unbeatable. That is the core message of King Suhaildev's story. The problem is we Indians are usually divided. We keep fighting with each other. We find some or the other excuse to start fighting with each other. It's one of the reasons why we are liberal as well. Because we love different points of view. We are not a compliant culture which will follow only one path. We have multiple paths. And the core, you know, the corollary to that is we end up fighting with each other often. When we are not at threat, that is okay. But when we are under threat, as we are today, you know, when there is a country that is trying to invade us, we need to be united.
How do you look at being a warrior? What defines a warrior? It is just someone who fights a battle or who gives everything into it. Or as you said, the last person also he killed so that the rain doesn't come back for like 116 years odd there to count. So what is warrior according to you?
You know, warrior often gets defined by only someone who's actually carrying out violence. But the way I see it, you know, warrior is someone who's willing to take on risk on himself for the good of others. That's a warrior. Many of us are not warriors. We don't have that bravery, right? But there are some who do have. They are the obvious warriors who are our soldiers on the front. I mean, fighting in sub-zero temperatures to stop an invading army. But they aren't the only warriors around, right? So as you mentioned rightly, the COVID warriors, there are, you know, I was just read of this very sad story of a doctor who passed away, a young doctor, around 30, 35. Who passed away because of COVID. Many of our doctors are actually putting their lives at risk, but for the good of others, for the good of the society, for the good of people they don't even know. But a warrior quality is someone who's willing to put his life at risk for someone he does not even know, for a stranger. That's what our doctors are doing, right? They're putting their lives at risk for strangers. Soldiers are putting their life at risk for strangers who just happen to be their countrymen. You know, our sanitation workers are putting their lives at risk because of the COVID pandemic. For our officers, you know, are putting their lives at risk for their fellow countrymen who are strangers for them, right?
According to you, Amish, now that you've written this book in 200, or I mean 200, I'm saying 2 years. I mean, I don't know how many days goes into that. What has been that moment? I mean, it must have taken a long to bring this. I mean, there's a process that must be going around making a book, how you make the draft, and you read 500 pages odd for one page that you write. That's the average reading statistics that you know you have given.
So, I read a lot.
You read a lot.
But it's like this, is that when I'm doing research, when I'm reading, I'm not really thinking about where the research will go. I just research because I like researching. I just like reading. I'll buy, you know, milk, I'll buy salt, I'll buy every damn thing possible, because God knows I might use only 5 things of them, but I'll buy 500 things.
You like
good
storage.
It's the same thing with research for me, right?
Yeah.
I fortunately am able to store all of that in my mind, right? So I keep just gathering as much research as I can, and what will go where one never knows, right? So you know, some of the battle tactics that are used, some of the duels that are used, are stuff I would have read in another context, but that gets used here.
Is the filtering process difficult? Like when you have to just take out and be like, I want to use this and make this, or write Sohail Dev. So what was the filtering process for writing this book?
You know, honestly, the filtering process is the easiest thing to do, because I don't do it, Lord Shiva does it. You know, so I've always said often that, you know, that my stories are the blessings of Lord Shiva. I don't create the stories, I'm only a channel. He sends the stories to me and I write what I receive. I gather as much research as I can. Now, what research will go into what story, that's up to Lord Shiva. He decides. When I'm writing, I don't really think about the research. That is just like information that's there. The back of the mind.
It the comes database.
Up. Yeah, it's a database. It's a database. What will come into the story is up to Lord Shiva. He just decides. And I just go with the flow. I just write instinctively. That factor comes in even when I'm thinking of what book I should write. What subject should I take up? You know, so it has to be something that just inspires me. There's no logic for it. You know, so if for example, I had to leave the, say, what subject I should write to, say, the publisher or the marketing team, they would have told me, yaar, King Sohail Dev, no one has heard of him. You know, he might have been a great warrior, but even people within UP haven't heard of him. How will we market him? How will it sell? They would have used all that logic and dissuaded me from writing the book. But I don't go through that process. I just, whatever story inspires me, I will write.
Was there some element emotionally of his personality that you related to, that this is something, you know, I can understand the character? It's more like making a movie around, you know, you're understanding that character. You are the player, you're the actor, you're the script writer. Everything is done by you.
And I'm not an actor.
Yeah.
I don't look good enough to be an actor. As far as the story is concerned, I think what truly inspired me, and I don't, I never hide it. I speak of it very openly. I'm a very, very, very patriotic person. I love our ancient culture. I love who we are. I love our heritage. But that does not mean that I will ignore things that need to be improved. Things which need to be improved, like, for example, how women are treated in India today. I speak of it, and it's not, I won't call it criticism. It's something, you know, my country can be better than this. So if there are things which then connect to this deeply core emotional thing about me, you know, then I get inspired. And what is it about King Sohail Dev that inspired me so much? He's from a subaltern caste. He's not an upper caste. He wasn't a Kshatriya. He's from a subaltern caste who rises at a time when India is facing perhaps the most brutal invading army the world has ever seen. The Turks were originally not from Turkey. They're originally from Central Asia. And the Turks did look like Ranveer Singh and Hema Malini and all. They don't look Indian. To us, they would have looked Chinese. Indian movies have created a lot of confusion as well. Okay, they were from Central Asia, and they were the military superpower of the world from the 11th to the 17th century. Almost no one could stand in front of them. They didn't just attack and destroy India. They attacked and destroyed the Arab world.
Everywhere, yeah.
Europe, they were the foot soldiers of the Mongol armies that went to China. They were, And they were warriors like the world has never seen. Brutality beyond imagination. Okay. Like ISIS and Nazi Germany would be nothing compared to them. Okay.
And that's the gravest image we have of the brutality.
Of brutality. Like happened, Nazi right? Germany is the worst.
Yeah, nothing it's worse.
Like the Turks. Timur, for example, was a Turk. 800, not Saif Ali Khan wala Timur.
You catch the nerve in the thought process so easily.
No, I saw your expression. So I said, no, he's an exceptionally cute baby, Timur. I'm talking about the historical Timur.
I got it, yes.
800 years ago.
Yeah, the name was a
Turk.
Historic.
He was a Turk. He wasn't an Indian. He was a Turk from Central Asia. He massacred 5% of the world's population. 5% of the world's population. Can you imagine that 800 years ago? When if you think about it, it wasn't easy to kill 5% of the world's population. Because you had no nuclear bombs, you had no dynamite, you had no machine guns. Killing wasn't so easy those days. Today, I'm putting the morality aside. I'm just saying ki, in today's day, killing is not so difficult. You can just press a button and a missile can go. But in those days, you had to stab, you had to behead. It wasn't easy. It took a lot of effort to kill someone. He killed 5% of the world's population through that method. Can you imagine how brutal he and his army would have been? Okay. Now an army of Turks invaded India and many major kings surrendered or lost, right, to the Turks. And here was, a subaltern caste king from a small kingdom, called Shravasti, which is ahead of Ayodhya, who puts an army together of Hindus of all castes, of Indian Muslims, of Indian Buddhists, and defeats these guys, these all conquering Turks. And he defeats them, and he defeats them in such a devastating manner that no Turkic tribe comes back for 160 years. I mean, if you think about it, what a man. And in any other country, statues of a man like this would have been on every city. He would have been there in every history book. People would have been celebrating him. And this to me is the criticism of India today, that we don't even remember him. Shame on us. What do our heroes who fight for us, who die for us, what do they expect from us, the ordinary people? They don't expect us to be as heroic as they are. And stand on their side. It's not just about soldiers. It's about the doctors, sanitation workers, police officers, all of them. They don't expect us to be as brave as they are. They know we are not. We cannot be standing next to them and putting our lives at risk. But what they expect at the minimum is we should at least remember them. We should at least remember their stories.
It's also because our education system has groomed us in a way to read what we have been told to read according to the channelizing of the boards and systems. So how much we know is what we are told to know.
The fault is with our education system. Our education system still carries forward the old colonial approach. It's not just true in our history, in almost every subject. We don't speak of our Indian heroes at all. We keep speaking about Western heroes. Our history, another thing is our history has an excessive Delhi bias. Delhi is an important city, but it's not the only part of India. There are many other parts of India. And all other parts of India have been ignored, frankly. Any part which is, you'll notice in our history books, if an empire is too big to be ignored, then it is covered. Like the Mauryas and the Guptas, their center was Bihar, right? So they are not ignored because they are too big to be ignored. Mauryas were the biggest empire ever. Guptas were the second biggest empire. They can't be ignored, right? But almost every other empire which did not have its base in Delhi has been ignored. Like the Palas, the Buddhist Palas, who were from Bengal. And at the peak, the Pala Empire was bigger than that of Akbar. But they've been wiped out of our history books. The Cholas from South India, they've been wiped out.
There's a small mention every time.
Yeah,
like dates and history.
The Marathas. Let's be honest, before I've said this so often, before Sanjay Leela Bhansali made his movie on Peshwa Bajirao, how many Indians had heard of Peshwa Bajirao? Right? And the British didn't conquer India from the Mughals. The British conquered India from the Marathas. And so all other parts of India, the Hoysalas, Gurjar Pratiharas, the Sikh Empire, any empire which did not have its base in Delhi has been wiped out of our history books. This is wrong. This needs to be corrected. Our education system truly needs to be connected to our roots and give us a more holistic perspective of India. But here again, I will lay the blame on us Indians, on us common Indians as well. Because look, we can't keep blaming the British forever. They've been gone for 70 years. Yeah? Who stopped us from reforming our education system?
I wanted to ask you one thing that you connected with Sohail Dev so much, with especially where he came from and what he took on to. Did you also understand his mind? What could have gone to him at that time? Today, we are talking about people working their mental health so much. We have so many ways to correct our hair, mind and work towards a thing. That time, we wouldn't have so many ways. What could have worked with a warrior at that age when technology was not so upgraded like today? Did you understand what kind of mindset they had? What strength was there in their focus and mind that let those warriors come up and battle it out? Like, which we might not see. Like, we take an entire country to bring together the COVID warriors also. But they stood alone. So did you connect to that mind and that emotions they would grow up with?
In many ways, humanity has never had it better. In many ways. If you see from a pure material, practical perspective, in terms of safety and security, for example, you know, relatively small men as I am and women have never been more physically safe than today. Okay. Yes. In ancient times, it was all about physical strength. No? That was the primary driver. And you didn't have a gun which you could shoot from a distance. You know, so yes. Then, because gun then equates physical strength, right? It doesn't matter. And women on a per capita basis, you know, as Hans Rosling's book Factfulness will show you, this is the least violent humanity has ever been. On from a material perspective, middle classes today lead lifestyles that the royalty couldn't have lived, you know, 200 years ago. Think of the comforts that we are talking to each other from. You know, you're in India, I'm in London. We are talking online. We are able to see each other. I mean, this is almost like the power of God. If you know, if someone from 300 years ago time traveled to today,
even if Sohail Dev was alive, he would be like, dude, can we do this?
He's like, I am, ye kya ho raha hai? Correct. You know, the fact that there is a pandemic raging, but the probability of one of us, I know there are 800,000 or 900,000 deaths, which is terrible. I'm not denying that, you know, out of a population of nearly 8 billion. But earlier pandemics killed far more people proportionately. The Spanish flu killed 50 million people out of a population of 2.5 billion. So the probability of you dying was so much higher, right? Whereas today, the probability of you dying even from a terrible pandemic like this is relatively quite low. We can watch TV, we can read books, you know, food is not a problem. Earlier, so many people would starve to death, right? So in so many ways, humanity has never been better, never had it better. And yet, mentally and emotionally, we are so weak, right? Like a little bit of, you know, trouble in our lives. And we start thinking, you know, oh, I need some help. I need to take a break. I need to go to a psychologist. I'm not deriding the mental health issues. You know, so I'm not saying people aren't actually.
But it's true. It's so true because we're becoming helpless at the drop of a hat.
Why is this happening now when humanity faced far worse things a few centuries or 1,000 years ago, what King Sohail Dev and his people and his army faced.
Can't imagine.
But they never said, I am mentally troubled, I need a break, I need my safe space. No, they battled what they had to battle. Right? So despite us having everything, and after some time you'll find all the brands, all the social media, everything, you know, all this does not give you the strength that a few strong relationships give you, right? I think this is one of the key differences between humans today and humans in the past, because community bonds were strong. Look, no one escapes troubles in life. All of us will face troubles. No one has a bed of roses. Everyone has a share of grief. I've had a terrible time in my personal life in the last three, four years. All of us are cursed with our share of grief. What gets us through it is our bonds and our relationships, our family, our brothers, our sisters, our few close friends. Those, you know, and I've said this a few times that, you know, the people you meet on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram are not your friends. Okay? They are only acquaintances who you are engaging with. Your friends are those who will die for you without a second thought. or who you will die for without a second thought. They are your friends, and they're not more than 2-3 people.
Before I go ahead, I want to bring Shailesh there on screen from Russia. He's been quite waiting since our time zone is different, but he's been up like anything to speak. Shailesh, if you could come by on the screen and we could take this question that you wanted to ask Amish there. If you're there. Yeah.
Hi, Shailesh. How are you?
I'm great. It's really a pleasure to listen to both of you.
Thanks.
So I would be very much following the time because I know you're on a tight schedule. So my question to you is that you cover a lot about the Indian way of life, even though your stories are inspired by Shiva or comes to you through Shiva. But what about the global audience? Because today, the global readers, irrespective of their caste, creed, religion, are attracted to all kinds of writing. So in your mind, are you somehow thinking to attract the larger global audience, or is that not what your purpose at the moment right now?
You know, the thing is, I just write what stories inspire me. And there is a story idea that had inspired me, which I am thinking of developing, which is actually based in London now. It's set in the modern day. And it has elements of time travel and gaming and alien life as well. So it's a damn cool idea. So I think once I'm done with the Ramchandra series, I might take this up, or I might develop it as a, you know, as maybe a web series or a movie. So let's see. But it's something that has inspired me, and that's caught my imagination.
Many people might be excited just by the idea that you have something like this cooking in your mind. Many young people wish to write, but at the very first thought of thinking to write and the final thought of getting their books in the shelves, in the bookstores or online stores or wherever. So the whole ecosystem of the writing, publishing and all these things, is it too much crazy, or is the ecosystem not too clear?
To be honest, this is a problem in the publishing industry. It's not easy to get published, and especially those who are not from the right social classes, the right quote unquote, you know, matlab the elite social classes. So there is, for example, there is criticism of the publishing industry in the West as well, that they are not diverse enough. They don't give opportunities to those who are not from the old elite. And that criticism is fairly put on the Indian publishing industry as well. So that is a problem, no doubt. Especially if you're not from the elite classes, it can be a problem. The way I see it, however, if no one else backs you, the hell with it, you back yourself. You fight yourself. So my first book, for example, was rejected by every publisher it was sent to, and I self-published my first book.
Wow.
And God's grace, the book took off, and it did well. When I self-published my first book, 2010, we had to print a minimum number. We had to physically distribute it. It was expensive, right? And I had a job. So I, fortunately, it was a banking job. So I was earning enough. And I didn't have any baap dada ka jaidad. So I had nothing. You know, baap dada ka ashirwad hai, jaidad nahi hai. You know, so I invested from my salary into that. It took much more effort, much more expense to self-publish 10 years ago, but it took off, right? In today's day, it's very simple. You can go to many of these self-publishing sites on Amazon, Flipkart. You can upload your book. You can, you can do print on demand, which means you don't have to print a minimum number, which will take a lot of cost, right? Marketing, you can do it practically free. Who is stopping you from making YouTube videos, putting up Facebook posts? It's all in your hands. And depending on how well you do it, it can pick up. A motherland dies when her own children stop loving it. A nation is not built by those who hate it. It is built on the shoulders of those who love it. And as Lord Shiva is our witness, we Indians will never stop loving our land.
But really, your readings and your writings are much, which gives us an image. And we are very, very grateful to you. So thank you, Amish. Thanks for that wonderful time every time. And all the best, and we do want to see more of such things come out in picture manner, web series, as you had said.